world and the seven seas. Everybody's looking for something. Some of them want to use you. Some of them.
It. During the search for Tiffany Quinn, it breathes and aches like old oak, like peeling birch. One lost soul set free. It moves, a chess piece in the dark room, cast iron legs a centimeter at a time, crying out its silent carved graffiti, calling to its next victim, its next savior. Touch me. Save my soul. Chapter 1. Everything changes when Tiffany Quinn disappears. 178 of the 212 residents of Criers Cross, Montana, joined Sheriff Greenwood in a search that lasts 5 days from sunup to after dark. School is closed, students all taking part, searching roads and farms, trudging through pastures of cattle and horses, through sections of newly planted potatoes, barley, wheat, up to the foothills and back along the woods. They travel in groups of two or three, some nervous, some crying, some resolute, shouting to the other groups now and then so nobody else goes missing. Cell phones aren't much good out here. Criers Cross is a dead spot. But there is no trace of Tiffany Quinn. She is gone, impossibly. Impossibly, because to imagine foul play here in the humble town of Criers Cross is laughable. And to imagine that sweet ninth grade bookworm running away, going off on her own, also impossible. But gone she is. Kendall Fletcher flinches and casts regular glances behind her out of heaven. Scared about the younger girl's disappearance, true, but also unsettled for the shakeup in her schedule. The final week of her junior year canceled. Everything left unfinished, open-ended. The whole routine is off. She travels the hundreds of acres of her parents' farm and beyond into the woods, wearily counting her steps through the potatoes and grain fields and trees. Counting, always counting something. People, cows, deer, hoping not to have to count grizzlies or cougar. Her best friend Nico Cruz walks next to her. Boyfriend, he'd say. But boyfriend means commitment, and commitments she can't keep tend to make Kendall feel prickly. Come on, she says, let's run. She takes off through the field and Nico follows. They pass an imaginary soccer ball between the rows, occasionally yelling out, Tiffany! Once they see a big brown lump at the edge of Nico's family's barley field, but it's not Tiffany. It's just a roadkill deer. It's been 5 days. She's not here. She's not anywhere. They take a break under a tree at the edge of the farm as rain starts to fall. Kendall stares and counts the drops as they hit the gray dirt faster and faster. Nico talks. That Kendall isn't listening. She needs to get to 100 drops before she can allow herself to stop. Eventually, search ends. Tiffany's family is no better off, but nothing more can be done locally except by professionals now. May is prime planting season. Farmers have chores and students do too, plus jobs if they work in town or for one of the farmers or ranchers. Life has to go on. A long, hot, hard-working summer for Kendall. For everyone, after a month or two, people stop talking about Tiffany Quinn. That's the opening to Criers Cross.
The best birthday present you can give an author is to buy an extra copy of their book.
Right.
And then this for you, you get presents too.
Yes, totally.
Wonderful.
Okay.
Would you like right.
Yes.
Okay.
A
1, 2, 3.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Lisa. Happy birthday to you.
February of next year, so we've got a year to wait for the next book.